Welcome to Italics, television for the Italian-American experience. I'm your host, Anthony Tamburri. This month, we have a special guest, President Frank Wu of Queens College. Before coming to Queens College, he was provost and dean at the University of California Hastings School of Law. And before that, he was at Howard University, which is considered basically the historically black college university in this country. President Wu, welcome to Italics.
Great to be here with you, and do call me Frank.
So the first question I'm sure somebody would ask is, what are you doing at Queens? How do you go from San Francisco to Queens? I know the story, but our viewers would find it very fascinating.
I wanted to be at Queens College. I'll explain. You know, I was at a point in my career, people would contact me about college presidencies. I had headed a law school that was a standalone law school. So I was in charge of the whole place, but the only thing on the campus was a law school. So I'd get contacted from time to time by these search firms, these headhunters. And I didn't want just to be a college president. Now, there's nothing wrong with wanting to be a college president. I have many friends who want to be a college president. They go and they get that job. Well, they called me about Queens College. I said, all right, this is the place for me for two reasons. The first is the diversity of the borough. The whole world is in Queens. And that's not just my say-so. If you look statistically, there's no place anywhere where there are so many languages being spoken. It's apparently almost 200. You know, I didn't even know there were 200 languages being used right now, but on our campus, it's 83 languages, last time we checked, that our students and their families speak. So I knew this is for me because my whole career has been about diversity and civil rights and the diaspora from the world over, and the whole world comes to Queens. The second reason is we still believe in the power of higher education, American higher education, as the engine of the American dream. That's how I got here. My parents came to the United States in the early 1960s. I'll be 54 this year. I was born here, but my parents came as scholarship students. I wouldn't be here if it weren't for American higher education. So this is just coming full circle. That's why I wanted to be at Queens College, not any college. So that was the only search I was in, because this is a place where, you know, a lot of folks talk about diversity, equity, and inclusion, especially now. And they talk about how higher education is going to help you reach your aspirations. Right. But the truth is, a lot of places, that's sort of rhetoric, because there are places now, if you can believe it, you send your kid to college, it's going to cost you $75,000 for 1 year. You know, that's crazy. You know, by the time you're done, that's a mortgage on a house. And if you got two or three kids, I don't see how a middle-class family does that. But at Queens College, we still live up to these aspirations, these great ideals.
And that's something I've always said since I've been here, and that is the cost of a full-time student for the year at Queens, CUNY, senior colleges is like $7,300 or $7,400, which is outrageously low when you consider what it costs to go to, oh, some nice sort of fancy, quaint little liberal arts college, which is five times as much, if not more, right?
It doesn't make any sense. Almost half our students still pay nothing, thanks to the very generous support. And, you know, it's not charity, it's an investment. The way I think about it, and we can show this, there are people who do these studies, and they show when you invest a dollar, you get back about $5, because our students, they become entrepreneurs. They take the skills, they start a business, they pay taxes, they hire folks. And so it makes sense. And we used to believe that, you know, when Italians were coming to the United States in massive numbers, when Asians were coming, there was a belief that we had once that we need these institutions to lift up whole communities, not just individuals, and that it would be a public investment in the common good. Somewhere along the way, we sort of lost that faith, you know? It became, you want a degree, you pay for it.
Yeah.
Well, at Queens College, we still believe in this common good, right? And I think that view's coming back as we emerge from the pandemic, because people see, all right, we got to rebuild. And that doesn't mean just you rebuild or I rebuild. I mean, it's together. We got to do this together.
And so you get hired just at the beginning of COVID, and you begin July 1st in 2020. So we're like 4 months into really hot, horrible stuff. So my question has always been, starting a new job as president of a university college has to have its own jitters, right? Pre-job jitters. But now this is compounded by COVID. What was going on in your head?
Yeah, your head? I embrace the challenge. I'll tell you, it's easier to start under circumstances like that. Here's why. Here's the first thing. You have a priority. Everyone gets it. We all have the priority, which is we got to make it through this pandemic. We got to deal with this. And it made the word unprecedented a cliche, right? Because no one had ever been through this. No one is going to look at me and say, hey, the last guy did a better job during the last pandemic, right? So there's no there's no comparison, right?
I think everyone at Queens also feels that it's gone a lot better than perhaps, you know, one might have imagined at the beginning. You as president, new president, coming in or meeting all new people, and we, I think, as a body, we've reacted well to it. And so I'm hoping that the fall is going to be better than right now what we're planning.
And there's an opportunity. You know, we're always living through history, right? But we hardly ever catch ourselves and think, this is historic, right? But this is. We're all self-aware, and never in my lifetime, and probably never in the lifetimes of anyone now alive, has there been a consensus, regardless of who you are, where you're from, what your station in life is, that, hey, we're starting over again. We've never had a moment like this. It doesn't matter what your politics are, right? We know we have an opportunity that we've never had before to sort of look at a blank piece of paper and say, what do we want Queens College to look like? What do we want society to look like? And that's great.
Among other things, you're a scholar. You have written on ethnicity and you've written on inter-ethnic relations, right? You've done work on African Americans and Chinese Americans. And I want to ask you about this. We talk about Asian Americans, but there are Chinese Americans, there are Japanese Americans, and so on and so forth, right? And for our history here, I would say that historically, right, we go back, it's Chinese and Japanese. We're Italian-American and we have Italian-American.
Right.
We don't have any, for lack of a better word, quote unquote, competition among our Italians, right? But the term Asian-American, it seems to me that sometimes it dilutes a little bit the issues of Chinese-Americans and the issues of Japanese-Americans and so on and so forth.
Yeah, that's a great question. So, you know, I sometimes explain, there are no Asians in Asia. When I say that, people are kind of puzzled. What do you mean there are no Asians in Asia? Well, you know, if you went to Shanghai or Seoul or Saigon and you walked down the street and you just accosted the random man or woman and said, who are you? What are you? They're not going to say they're Asian. They're going to say they're Chinese, Japanese, Korean, Indian, Pakistani, Filipino, Burmese, Laotian, Cambodian, Hmong, you name it. But maybe one out of 100 is going to say, I'm an Asian, right? They identify by ethnicity, by national origin, by faith, by language, by dialect, by province, by clan. Two generations ago, three generations ago, they were fighting total wars against one another, right? I mean, you know, there's no love lost among them. They hated each other. Pan-Asian identity was associated with imperialism, right? Japan, for example, during World War II, they had this idea. It was called the East Asian Co-Prosperity Sphere. That was a euphemism. It meant Japan was going to take over all of its neighbors, right? So that was sort of Asian unity, right? But it wasn't. But then you come here and you hear, you all look alike, right? And then you realize, well, we better get organized. And since everyone thinks we're all the same, even if our grandfathers were fighting in wars against each other here, we got to see the common cause. So the term Asian American has two origins. When my parents came here, they weren't Asian American. I mean, they weren't Asian and they weren't American, right? That's just not how they saw themselves and it's not how others would have seen them. So in 1968, or which is a year of revolution, you know, students marching and protesting all around the world, there was, and this sounds crazy now, but there was actually a yellow power movement modeled on black power. And it was mainly in California. They had folk music, underground magazines. It was a real countercultural movement, right? There are a couple of history books that have been written about, but most people don't know, unless you were back there then in the day, you wouldn't know about this, right? There were two students, Japanese-American fellow named Yuji Ichioka and Chinese-American woman named Emma G. And they came up with this idea. They said, were Asian American. They made up the word, and it was a coalition. Sometimes people say, well, this is balkanizing, it's fragmenting, it's divide. That's not true at all. It brought folks together, Chinese and Japanese, who their grandparents, they didn't like one another, all right, but here they wanted to say, we're Asian American, we got this common cause, and we're American. We were born here, we're equals, we're staying, we're not tourists, we're not going back, because this is our home. Then in 1977, the US government, the OMB, passed Directive 15. Now, unless you're a bureaucrat, you've never heard of Directive 15. However, it's affected all of our lives. Directive 15 said the federal government is going to keep statistics now, and it's going to have five categories for race. It's still in place now, half a century later. They've revised it just a little bit, but basically it's five categories, and Asian was one of them. So Asian American comes from these two very strange, different sources, student activism and government bureaucracy. But, you know, it turns out nothing is ever new or original. There's an analogy when you think about things. I've really enjoyed learning about Italian American history. And one of the things that I've been learning about, you can tell me more about this, is that many Italian Americans, when they came, they weren't Italian Americans, at least the very first wave, because Italy wasn't yet quite a nation state, right? So Italian unification had to occur, and from what I've read, there are even some old-timers today who, they're Sicilian, right? They're from Genoa, Piedmont, right? They have a very specific identity, and North and South, maybe they don't get along so well.
And actually, there are grandchildren and great-grandchildren of those immigrants who continue to say, are you Italian? Yeah, I'm Sicilian. Yeah. And they're like three generations removed. Yeah, no, that exactly. We call it campanilismo, loyalty to the bell tower, right, of the village, you know.
That's right.
Yeah, exactly. Italy was unified officially in 1861. Some people will tell you it's still not unified 160 years later. But yeah, exactly. We have that still going on today.
Even the global connections,
right,
aren't new. We tend to think globalization, this is all new. It's because we've got the internet, because you can get on an airplane and fly around. But, you know, one of my favorite painters is a fellow named Giuseppe Castiglione, who hardly anyone in the West has ever heard of him. The reason is he was an Italian Jesuit who, this is like four centuries ago, went to the imperial court of China and stayed, and basically, though he was an Italian Jesuit, sort of turned himself into an honorary Chinese citizen and became a court painter and this artist who's renowned. He also painted dogs and horses, all these natural scenes. And he kind of blended European and Asian techniques. Many of the great Chinese cultural treasures were created by an Italian Jesuit centuries ago.
Yeah.
You know, if you can believe it.
Yeah. There's a relationship there, you know, with Italy and China, whether it's the question of the Chinese in Italy and what that all pertains
today, right? Yeah.
To. And, you know, some people jokingly will say that, you know, the oldest Chinese are in Italy, because I guess there was this usage that when someone died, they just gave the document to someone who was undocumented, whatever. And Prato, the city of Prato outside of Florence, is the textile, yes, center, for example, that, you know, the Chinese haven't, quote unquote, taken it over. They bought the Italian factories, and this is something, you know, occasionally my Italian friends are going to hate me for this, but occasionally you'll hear the Chinese thing over Prato, the textile industry. Well, gee, you know, so-and-so's family just sold their textile company to the Chinese. There's a lot we can do
with that. I'd love to grow that at Queens College.
Yeah.
I really hope to grow everything that we do about diaspora, about ethnicity, because we have Calandra. We're so proud that it's affiliated with Queens College. We have Africana, we got Asian American, we got Latinx, we got Jewish, Greek, you name it. And Queens College is the place for it.
And we just come off of the strategic planning that we've been doing this year.
Thank you for your work.
Yeah.
Thank you.
And I was involved with the Diversity, Equity, and Inclusion Committee. And I must say, it was really productive. I think everyone in that group learned something new. I think we realized there were other things to know, you know, and getting to understand other characteristics about different groups, whether we're dealing with ethnicity, whether we're dealing with race, whether we're dealing with ableness, and things of that sort.
Yeah, and that history is so important. It's part of American history, and it's also distinctive. You look at issues like Sacco and Vanzetti. In the day, that was the big case for a whole decade. That's what people argued about at the dinner table. It's what was in the newspaper. And it made it clear that folks of Italian background, boy, did they face a lot of bias, right? And stereotyping, right? Radical, not loyal to the United States, dangerous, anarchist, criminal. That history, we've sort of forgotten so much of that, even though it's beneath the surface.
As most of, I think, our viewers know, we're in a building on 43rd Street, which has five floors, I think, that CUNY occupies. There's the Calandra Institute, there's a School of Labor and Urban Studies here, which is the newest school, I think, at CUNY. And there's also the Asian American Research Institute, which is on the 10th floor. So we're neighbors.
That's right.
Let's talk a little bit about diversity, because we are on, in a good sense, this campaign to diversify even more Queens College, right?
Yes.
The faculty especially. What are some of the challenges here, in your opinion, to diversify more the faculty? What do you think?
Well, you know, I'm not going to say that there aren't enough folks out there.
No.
Because they're out there.
Yes.
We just have to find them.
Yeah.
And we have to be open and understand that not everyone comes from the same background. Right? That's something else that the pandemic has actually taught us, that there's a difference between what really counts, right? What, you know, because everyone talks about merit and who's qualified. Well, there are a lot of things you realize doesn't matter so much. It doesn't matter how nice someone's wardrobe is, and that's something the pandemic has taught us. I don't care how expensive your shoes are. I can't see your shoes. I don't care about your shoes. I'm not impressed by your shoes, right?
Yeah.
So that kind of falls by the wayside. There's a lot of stuff that we thought was important that it turns out those are just kind of distractions. And when you get right down to it, then you can look at, well, what will a person bring to the table? And at someplace like Queens College, you got to be good as a teacher, as a scholar, and as an institutional citizen, all of that. You know, there are a lot of places out there. You and I both know as professors, there are a lot of places they talk about research and teaching, but some of the places, it's just all research. You could be the worst classroom teacher. Mm-hmm. They don't care, right? As long as you're publishing and doing all that. Other places, they don't care if you publish anything, right? It's just all about the teaching. Well, what I love about Queens College is it's both. Someone like you, you're doing it all. Plus, you're doing all the service. And that counts, too, because we need people to be involved and engaged and understand this is a community. This isn't just a job. You do this because you believe we have a mission. So there's a lot for us to do. We always face resource constraints.
You know,
I would say that's the number one thing.
Right.
Because sometimes someone says to me, hey, wait a minute. There's this other school. I go there. They're going to pay me $25,000 more. And I look at it and I say, yeah, that's going to be tough, because if I pay you $25,000 more, well, then I got 10 other people who are going to come and say, why is he getting $25,000 more? Or they come and they say, that other school, I only have to teach half of what you're going to make me teach, right?
Right.
And that's tough too, because as soon as I cut a deal for the one person, I got 10 more people coming and saying, well, you just cut a sweetheart deal for that person. So it's that kind of competition. And I'm hoping we can attract people through, for example, cluster hiring.
Yep.
You can't just bring one person in. That's why I'm so proud of Italian American Studies here. Because we don't just have you, we got two distinguished professors. You're not going to find that anywhere else, right? Because it wouldn't be fair to just say, you have to represent Italian Americans all the time for everything, right? I mean, that's an impossible burden.
We do have other faculty at Queens who do Italian American Studies and who do Italian other studies. In the history department, we have Peter Vellin, and we have fashion studies with Eugenia Paolucelli, who's interdisciplinary in that field. She doesn't do just Italian. So we do.
We have so many faculty who know Europe incredibly well from every discipline, whether it's history or sociology or economics. And we have people who do interdisciplinary work. So it's more than one region, or it's more than one academic field, and they're bringing it all together. That, you know, I want us to be the school of the double major and the triple major, mm-hmm. the school where, you know, ethnic studies is not something off on its side. Mm-hmm. But you look at it and you say, look, you want to be an educated person, an educated citizen of the world, you need to know something about some folks who don't look like you, mm-hmm. all right? Pick whatever community it mm-hmm. is that you're curious about. You should know about your own ancestors, right? But let's pick one more, and let's everyone should do two, right? And that's valuable. You know, everyone talks, especially now, about diversity is our strength, right? But most places, to be honest, it's just talk, right?
There's a lot of chatter out there.
And I can say I wouldn't be here if it weren't for diversity. My career started at Howard University, the nation's leading historically black institution of higher education. And that just changed my life profoundly.
So let me ask you, so you did your undergraduate, you went to law school.
That's right.
And then you went into teaching.
I practiced for just a few years. I wanted to have some sense of what it was like to be a lawyer.
I was always curious about that.
Just long enough to know, you know, the better I became as a lawyer, the worse I was as a human being. Now, I know some people, their lives, you know, they got one compartment that's their work life. Yeah. But I didn't want to be that person, right? You know, I'd like to think I was a pretty good lawyer, but that's just not the person I wanted to be.
It just didn't feel good, right?
Yeah, exactly. But it's a great skill set to be able to analyze the world and to look at it that way. But I knew that what I really wanted to do was change the world. I wanted to write and speak and be an advocate. And so that's why.
You went to Howard.
That's right. And I learned as much as I taught. You know, I didn't grow up in a predominantly black environment.
Right.
And
you grew up in Detroit.
Yeah. I grew up in the suburbs of Detroit, right? So my father worked for one of the big four U.S. automakers. And I later returned to Detroit, and I actually bought a home right downtown, which Detroit started to have a little bit of a renaissance. But when I bought my house, people were shocked. They said, well, you don't have to live in the city. I said, yeah, I understand that. I want to be here because that's the whole point of why I'm here. But when I went to Howard University, I realized, despite myself, that we all have prejudice, just kind of the images rattling around in the backs of our heads. I enjoyed privilege. You know, walking down the street, sometimes kids come up to me and they do karate kung fu moves, right? Yeah. Or, you know, there's the common cruelty of childhood bullying, right?
Right.
But for my colleagues, my students, when they walk down the street, you know, well, it's like that bird watcher case last year in Central Park.
Right.
People call 911 and then they look at you and they think you're a thug. Or it's the jogger, Ahmed Aubrey, who was hunted down and killed, you know.
Right.
And so being at Howard University just transformed my life and made me see the diversity among African-Americans, not just among African-Americans, the African diaspora. People who are Caribbean, who are Haitian, who are Nigerian, who are Jewish, who are Afro-Asian, who are Italian and black, one or two here or there, but you add it up and suddenly you realize, wow, some people might just walk by and think everyone there is the same, but you get to talk to them and you realize, well, and we've got Baptists, we've got Episcopalians, we've got Muslims, we've even got a Buddhist or two, right? So you just see this diversity inside diversity, and that was so important for me, for my development to see.
And what department were you in?
So I was at the law school. I was the first Asian-American law professor.
Okay.
The things I learned, you can't learn out of a book. You have to go there and be there and just have your eyes open and be surrounded by that. So I've always wanted to go to places where people wouldn't expect me to show up. And to tell you the truth, maybe I didn't expect me to be there either.
Yeah.
But that's how I've just developed. And once you start doing that, you realize, hey, you know, you're a better person if you do that. I know there are some folks who might look and say, wait a minute, why would you think about Italian Americans? And, you know, my thinking's the other way around, you know. Why wouldn't we be thinking about Italian Americans? There's so much that's interesting.
Yeah.
As I learn from you and more about the Italian American experience, I realize, wow, there's a lot here that I didn't know that's important. You know, here's just an example of something. Lee Iacocca, in his memoirs, he passed away not that long ago. His memoirs came out in maybe the 80s, back when he was really famous.
Still at the height of
his. He was such a businessman, celebrity. They talked about maybe he'd run for president someday. Right. In his memoirs, he has a little passage at the beginning about when he was growing up. So this must have been, I'm thinking, right after World War II, how pizza was an ethnic food. And other kids, when he ate pizza, would kind of make fun of pizza. That's so interesting because pizza is accepted as, you know, all American now.
Right.
But so something happened along the way where pizza stopped being ethnic and became American, right? That's actually an interesting story, right? A student could write a great paper, a teacher could write a book. Just looking at how does that happen? How does a community's food go from what is that? You know, what is pizza pie, right? You know, it's the Dean Martin song, right? Mm-hmm.
Right, exactly. That's Amore. And I think what we'll find is that there's so much more that's in common than we thought. It's something we've learned perhaps even from some of the tragedies that we've seen, especially in these last 2 years, year and a half, 2 years, right?
Your work has been so thoughtful where it's rooted in Italian-American studies, but you look at issues, George Floyd, Black Lives Matter, and I commend you for that because, you know, sometimes critics of what you do, what I do, they come along and they say, hey, these folks are just promoting separatism and complaining. But that's not it at all. What we're doing is showing, hey, if you go back and look at American history, people of Italian descent were there, people of Chinese descent were there. They've been there from the get-go.
Yep.
It's just been marginalized. It's been pushed to the side. And once you restore it, that's not complaining. That's celebrating. It's actually a great positive story for America that it just welcomes successive groups. And it hasn't been perfect, but we continue to make good on our principles over time.
This is one of the first days that you're out and about. We're just delighted and privileged to have had you visit us.
Thank you, Anthony. It's an honor to join you today.
Thank you for watching this episode of Italics. I'm Anthony Tamburri. Arrivederci alla prossima puntata.